Hello students, this is your faculty Rachna Gupta. Hello everyone, this is your faculty Rachna Gupta, and today's topic that we are going to study is monetary policies of RBI, and this topic is in particular your unit number 4. So let's begin. What do we mean by such policy which is governed by RBI and what impact it has in our own economy? So to begin with, what do we mean by this particular policy? So let's understand. So monetary policy is referred as the economic policy with the help of which the level of money is being regulated by the particular bank which is considered in our own economy with the name of Reserve Bank of India, that is RBI. Now this particular bank is a central bank, and this particular bank looks into the amount of credit or the amount of money which will flow in this economy. So this RBI announces this particular policy, monetary policy, twice a year in order to maintain the stability of price in the economy. Now those two policies are referred as slack season policy and busy season policy, which happen in the month of April to September, as in the first case slack season, and for the busy season, that is from the duration of October and March. Now let's see what are the objectives of this particular monetary policy that we are talking about. What aim is exactly the RBI does, or what is the function by introducing such policy in the economy? So first basic objective of RBI is to ensure maximum feasible output, which means that with the amount of credit that flows in an economy, the businessmen will either utilize it in the maximum capacity, or in case of excessive supply within the economy, government will try to take away that particular amount of money, because excess money in the hand of people will increase the demand in the particular economy. And since the supply cannot be increased at a really faster level, so there will be inflation in the economy. So with the first objective of monetary policy is to ensure that there is a sufficient output in order to maintain the demand and supply situation in the economy. Second one is high rate of growth. Since every economy's purpose is to achieve maximum growth, now how is that achieved? With the level of amount of money that is there in the economy, with the amount of money business activities run, with the same business activities people get employed, they can have their purchasing power, they'll be demanding goods, and ultimately those goods will flow in our economy. So the rate of growth is also governed by the monetary policy. Number third is fuller employment. Just like we just said about in the last 2 points, that with the flow of money in the economy, a lot of production activities are engaged. Since there will be mass production, there are chances that a lot of people will be employed as well. So the aim of monetary policy is to also ensure that maximum employment opportunities are generated for the people working in the nation. Number next is price stability. That also we have just discussed, that the situation between demand and supply needs to be matched up. Because in either cases, if this demand and supply doesn't match, the situation can be of inflation or recession. So the object of monetary policy is to also ensure that there is a correct balance between demand and supply. For the next, we have greater equality in the distribution of income and wealth. That is, the society should not be divided into two classes, that is rich and poor. So with that, monetary policy tries, and it aims at that this particular difference between the wealthy and that is the poor, that is reduced to maximum capacity. Next one is healthy balance in balance of payments. Since country is importing and exporting as well, so there are chances that we might have excess of imports as compared to exports. So with the help of monetary policy, a correct balance is maintained, so that there is a balance between import and export that happen within the nations. Moving further, what are different instruments that are used under the monetary policy? Or they can also be known as tools which are used under monetary policy by the Reserve Bank of India. Now these two tools are divided in the following categories. The category number one is quantitative tools, or which is also known as traditional measures. Now, why they are known as quantitative? Because they only look into the quantity of money which will flow in our economy. Second is qualitative measures, or which is also known as selective measures. That is, apart from controlling the volume of credit in the economy, there are certain actions which the RBI takes. So now we will move further one by one what those categories are. Under the first category that we are talking about quantitative measures, now we will try to look up for the basic forms. First form is open market operations. Second one is discount rate, which is also known as bank rate. Third one is cash reserve ratio. Fourth one is covered under category of others, which include SLR. Second one is repo rate. Third one is reverse repo rate. Now we understand them one by one in detail. The first one, that is, I said, open market operations. Now what these are? Now these are referred as the securities of the government. Now what these securities do, since the government is monitoring the supply of money in the economy, so with the help of these securities, government is able to either sell them or buy them in order to control the amount of money in the hands of people. Now there are two situations where the RBI could sell the government securities, and the second one where RBI is going to buy the securities. Let's talk about the first case, which it says that when RBI sells government securities. So what will this do? If the RBI is ready to sell the government securities, it will reduce the amount of cash, that is money in the economy. So it will reduce the overall supply of money which is available in the hands of banks. And since the availability of cash with the bank will be reduced, so this will further reduce the amount of capital which is there with the bank, which the bank will use for lending purposes. So ultimately rate of interest goes high, and what will ultimately happen, the people won't be asking for a number of loans. Since the number of loans would be reduced, the manufacturers won't be able to conduct large scale production. Since large scale production won't be there, so a number of demand would be there, particularly there, and this will somewhere reduce the amount of supply of cash in the economy. Second one is when RBI is going to buy those securities. In this situation, this will increase the money supply which is be there in the hands of bank. So interest rate would be moving down, and further a lot of business activities will take place, because now banks will have money in their own hands. So businessmen will get their loans at a particular subsidized interest. So finally there will be huge investment. Since the level of investment would be higher, there will be large scale production. When there will be large scale production, a lot of people will be employed, and ultimately the economy is going to move. Now let's understand that what happens for the demand and supply in relation to the amount of credit which is going to be available in the economy. So with the supply of credit which is there in the economy, the government bonds are sold, or they are even bought through the mechanism of checks which are drawn on some particular bank, and those are made in favor of the central bank. So ultimately what happens, money gets transferred from the buyer's account to the central bank's account. So this will reduce the total number of deposits in the hands of commercial bank and their reserves as well. So entirely their cash creation capacity is impacted in that sense. Furthermore, we say that when commercial banks are buying, their ultimately cash reserve will also go down. So which will lead to fall in the flow of credit that they will be supplying in the general market. Talking second about demand for credit, since the selling of bonds which is being taken up by the central bank, the rate of interest would go up, and this would ultimately reduce the demand of credit, because nobody would like to pay an extra money for availing that credit. So for the time being process, this particular measure can help us in reducing the supply of money. Now moving ahead with the limitations of open market operation. Now first particular limitation is that if commercial banks possesses extra liquidity, then this particular operation is not successful. Reason is because this is for a very time being, a very shorter duration. So for a larger scale, that is on the money where which is flowing in excess quantity, this particular operation will not suffice its purpose. Second one is that since these securities have a very low rate of return, so a lot of people don't prefer to invest their money in government bonds and securities, so which might not be beneficial for an economy. Third one is in countries which are not that developed or which are underdeveloped, the banking system is also not that developed enough or it is not that integrated. So people are hesitant in purchasing the securities which is sold by the government because they do not trust the banking system, or due to lack of advancement of the banking industry in that economy, these operations cannot have a good case. Next one is, if we are in a particular economy where the market is unstable, where we have sudden booms and sudden depressions, so this particular concept of OMO, that is open market operations, fits. Second one, we come about to bank rate, or which is also referred as the discount rate. So now the current rate that we can see is 5.40, which has been further reduced by the RBI, looking into the impact of coronavirus worldwide and specifically in India economy. So this was May prior to the impact of coronavirus, that is 5.4, which has been reduced for up to 4 days level. Now what this particular rate is, let's understand. So bank rate is referred as the minimum rate at which the central bank will provide loan to the commercial bank. So in that case only it is also referred as the discount rate, that means the rate at which the particular bank will discount the lending activities. Or it is also referred as the rate which is charged upon the borrowings, that is the loans that the bank is going to take from the central bank. So let's see what impact it will have in our own economy. Now, if we talk about the types of monetary policy that happen in our own country like India, so those types can be divided into two parts. That is, either it can be expansionary monetary policy or it can be contractionary monetary policy. So when we are talking about bank rate, if there is a fall in the bank rate, ultimately the aim of the central bank would be to expand the supply of money. So in case of the situation where government wants a lot of activities to take place in the economy, it will reduce its bank rate. Second one is a rise in the bank rate. If the government wants to control over the excess monetary supply in the economy, it will rise, it will provide an increase in bank rate, which will reduce the supply of money within the economy. So what actions the central bank is supposed to take and what effect it will have on credit, let's understand. Like I have already said that with the rise and then the fall of bank rate, the supply of money is controlled. So a rise or fall in the current rate of sentiment, the demand for the funds which are raised by the borrowers, they get affected. And secondly, bankers' lending rate get adjusted in accordance with the deposit rate. So rising the deposit rate will ultimately turn borrowers into depositors. So they will be depositing their money in return for a higher rate of interest that the bank is going to provide them. Thirdly, it says that rise in the bank rate will reduce the total net worth of the government bonds against the commercial banks that borrow funds from the central bank. So this is another measure through which particularly government can ensure monetary support. Just we have talked about limitations of OMO, that is open market operations, bank rate also suffer from certain limitations. Now these are, they can work effectively only when these conditions are followed. Now what those conditions are, let's see. When commercial banks approach the central bank for the borrowings, that means when commercial banks are looking elsewhere in order to have their own monetary supply, this particular rate does not provides any impact on the amount of or the supply of credit that they will be having. Second one is that if the commercial banks are more dependent upon the capital market for their finances, so they will never approach RBI for the funds. So ultimately this particular increase or decrease in bank rate will never suffice the purpose of the monetary policy. Third one is changes in the bank rate must influence interest rates at all. But these are what we see, that commercial banks hold their interest rates rather than getting it affected by the bank rate. That means they have options. They are using n number of ways through which they can have funds with their own self. or different ways through which the amount of credit or the supply of money can be there in their own hand. So ultimately, changes in the bank rate doesn't suffice the entire purpose of the monetary policy for which it is designed. Another particular measure that the government takes in the form of particularly controlling the amount of credit is by establishing cash reserve ratio. Now what this is, all commercial banks are required to keep a particular amount of its total deposits in the form of cash with RBI. So with the help of this particular reserve that the banks are maintaining with the RBI, an increase in the rate or with the decreasing in its rate affects the total supply of money in the hands of the commercial banks in relation with the central bank. So this percentage that the banks are maintaining in the form of reserve with the particular reserve bank in India is referred as cash reserve ratio. Why it is referred as cash reserve? Because the particularly banks are maintaining a reserve that is only in the form of cash with the RBI. So the current rate that we are talking about, what is the current rate of CRR, that is cash reserve ratio? So it is 4%. Next question arises, why it is required that banks are supposed to maintain this reserve with RBI? So the purpose of maintaining this reserve is elaborated in the following words. Like, for point number one, it says that to prevent shortage of cash. Like the every particular government wants to have a certain amount of cash at its own disposal to meet a certain requirement. So these requirements can be maintained when RBI is having that cash in its own self. Second one is in order to control the money supply. So I just said that we are understanding the different tools that the government is going to take in order to monitor or to reduce or to increase the supply of money. So with this particular reserve that the banks are maintaining, a control can be established on the supply of money. Third one is in contractionary policy, the bank raises the CRR. That means if the government wants that lesser amount of money should flow in the capital, they will increase this rate so that banks will have lesser amount in their own hand. Since bank will have lesser amount in their own hand, the lending activity shall be reduced, which will ultimately reduce the particular production activities and which will reduce the further demand and supply as well. Next is that in case of expansionary policy, bank will reduce the CRR. That is, now banks will have more money at their own disposal, which will increase the supply of money in the economy as well. It says that further, a hike in the CRR will lead to high interest rate, credit rationing, huge decline in investment, and large reduction in national income and employment. So this is quite relation that we have just talked about. What will be the impact if this particular ratio is increased or decreased? Now we are talking about the other methods. Under the first other method, we have SLR, which stands for statutory liquidity requirements, and the current rate is 18.25%. Now just similar to what reserve we have just talked about, that is CRR, this is another reserve that the banks are supposed to maintain. But there is a minor difference between the two. That is, CRR was in relation with the amount of cash that the banks were maintaining with the reserve bank. But this one stands within the form of liquid assets, like in the form of cash reserve, government bonds, gold, and etc. With those are the kind of reserve that banks are required to maintain with RBI. So this another measure is undertaken by the government in order to prevent the commercial banks to liquidate their liquid assets when this particular rate is increased or it is raised. Second one moving is repo rate. So the current repo rate is 5.95, which was further reduced looking into the situation of coronavirus in the economy for further 4%. So what is this rate? Now whenever the banks have any shortage of funds, they can always look up for RBI. So this is the rate at which banks will borrow the funds from the RBI. So what will happen if there is a reduction in the repo rate? This will help the banks to get money at a very cheaper rate. Now when banks are getting the particular money at a cheaper rate, they will be increasing this particular process. So they will be lending out n number of money to the people in the economy, which will increase the supply of money. Second one, it says that when the repo rate increases, borrowing from RBI becomes more expensive. That means when the government wants to control the amount of credit, it will increase this rate. So now getting the money from RBI will give me or will lead to paying off a higher rate of interest. Now, when I'm paying a higher rate of interest, I'll be having lesser money now in hand. So the amount of credit is controlled. So the repo rate transaction, these are used for very short duration. That is when we want to govern this particular supply in very immediate time manner, then these are effective. Third one is reverse repo rate, and the current rate is 4.90. Now, just like banks obtain funds from the RBI, similarly, RBI also can have sufficient amount of money when they require, and this requirement is fulfilled by taking the money from the commercial banks. So reserve repo rate or reverse repo rate is the rate at which banks will provide money to the RBI in exchange of its securities. So reverse repo rate is an arrangement where RBI is going to sell its securities to the banks for a very short period of time on a specified date that they will mention. And RBI uses this tool when there is a lot of liquidity which is there in the banking system. So in order to curb that liquidity or in order to reduce that liquidity, this particular rate is provided. Since now we have done about quantitative measures, that is looking into the amount of credit or the volume of credit which will be available in the economy, we are moving ahead for the qualitative measures. Under the qualitative measures, we have four. First one is credit rationing. Second one is change in lending margin. Third one is moral suasion. And the fourth one is direct control. Now let's understand them one by one in detail. First one is credit rationing. Now the word rationing means we are providing some sort of restriction on the amount of funds that are available. So by this method, the government is able to create shortage of funds and providing those funds in the prioritized sector which are there for the economy, like for the weaker industries. And in such a situation, what happens, the total amount of credit is reduced because for only important hours which are considered important in the eyes of the government, funds are provided. So companies or the manufacturers don't get the sufficient amount of money in the economy, and this will further reduce the amount of money in the economy. Second says that central bank does credit rationing because it looks into imposition of upper limits on the credit available to the large industries. It can decide the utmost limit to which industries can get their funds from the bank. And secondly, what they can do is charge a higher rate of interest for the loans that they have provided or they shall be providing beyond a particular limit. So when both of these things are done, ultimately what will happen, the amount of credit is reduced. Moving to the second one is change in the lending margins. Lending margin number, that does mean whenever I am taking a loan, I am supposed to give something in the form of security. So in this particular fund, bank will provide loan up to a very certain percentage in reference to the property that I have mortgaged with the banking authority. So the difference between the value of this particular mortgage property and the amount that I shall be having is referred as this lending margin. So with what central bank is going to do in order to decrease or increase the amount of credit, this particular lending margin is either reduced or increased. Now why does this particular thing happen? Because the objective of this particular margin is to control over certain speculative activities which happen in the stock market. So by increasing this particular rate or the margins or the difference between the amount or the volume of credit that I will have and in reference to the property that I have mortgaged or have submitted with the particularly banks, these can be checked in. Third one is moral suasion. Now this in total is referred as a psychological instrument which is helpful for the monetary policy. Now, what the government does in this, it tries to persuade and convince the commercial banks to advance credit in accordance with the directions given by the central bank. So that means here the entire play is of psychology. Furthermore, such as the central bank will use certain pressures on the commercial bank by going public on the unhealthy bank practices. That means these practices can be adopted when there are situations going not so favorable and the bank is having the only option to use this. Fourth one is direct control. This means that when all the methods turn out to be totally ineffective, what RBI can do, it can come directly in the economy, face to face with its own citizens and the different manufacturers or organizations, with exercising a different form of control directly in relation with the what it is already doing with the help of commercial bank. So commercial bank, apart from the central bank, will give clear-cut instructions to bank in order to carry out their activity in a specific manner as it is desired by the RBI. Now, since we have understood about meaning, objectives and different tools the government is going to use for the movement of supply or the movement of cash in our own economy, let's understand two different situations. That is, how the monetary policy is going to impact in the situation of recession and inflation. So first one is, if the economy is facing recession, now what will happen? First one is, what central government would do, it would buy the securities through open market operations. This particular situation will be further exercised by lowering the bank rate that we have already discussed before. And further, it will reduce the cash reserve ratio. Now with these three measures, what ultimately will happen, there will be an increase in supply of money in the economy. Now when there will be increase in supply of money, the interest rate will also be reduced because we have just studied in the above point. Furthermore, when the interest rates are being reduced, particularly companies will try to have more money from the banks. When they will have more money, they will be having huge investment. So there will be increase in investment. Further, when investment is increased, it will lead to demand, that is higher demand in the economy. When there is higher demand in the economy, so supply will be increased. So ultimately, a lot of money will be pumped up in the economy through this particular process of monetary policy. Coming to a second situation where there is excess money supply, where there is inflationary situation. Now, how can government control with the help of monetary policy? Number one is, it will sell out the securities. That means now people will buy and they will be paying to the government. Second one is, interest rate shall be increased, that is bank rate will be increased, which will ultimately lead to lesser amount of credit which is available in the hands of people. Third one is, availability of cash with the particularly commercial bank will also be reduced. So ultimately this will reduce the supply of money in the economy. Now when the supply of money will be decreased, the interest rate will be increased. Further next, when interest rates are higher in the economy, there will be declining investment because now manufacturers or the particular corporate houses would like to postpone their investment for a future time period. Now when investments are postponed, the demand would decline, and when the demand would be declined, ultimately that will lead to lesser amount of money in the particular economy, which will be benefited through lowering the level of prices. Since everything has a certain degree of limitations to it, even our so-called best policy in the world, in the monetary policy, it also has certain limitations to it. So these limitations are in the form of these four points. That is point number one, time lapse. Time lapse refer to the amount of time that is involved in making a policy, running the policy and getting the result of that policy that the government is going to introduce. So first one is time taken in implementation and working. That is inside lag and outside lag. That is when the government decides that a policy has to be made and how much time that takes for the government to get it implemented in the economy. So those time periods are really important. So if the government is not able to take quick action, so this policy might fail. Second one says that outside lab. That means I have applied the policy, but it requires a certain time period to check out the results. So if it is not applied in, on a correct time, the results cannot be beneficial. Second one is problem in forecasting. Since every decision in management is concerned with correct forecasting, so it is not dependent upon the government to have a clear-cut forecast about the clear-cut prediction of what will be the outcome of the policy, how that policy has to be made, on what area it has to be implemented, and up to what extent it will be applied. That is quite critical, and that's very difficult for a particular government itself. Third one is non-banking financial intermediaries. This means that in our own economy, apart from the banking in operation, there is a huge market through which I can obtain finance. That means same goes for the corporate houses. They have n number of sources from where they can obtain finance. So if I am trying to get the finance from other ways apart from banks, even if there is a strong monetary policy in my own economy, my availability of credit aids cannot be guaranteed. Next one is underdevelopment of money and capital markets. So this means that in a particular economy where there are markets which are unorganized, so this particular policy that is stated by the central bank of that particular country does not give a true impact, because markets do not have a unified structure and the people are able to get the money from different sources. So that's all for today. Hope you are safe and stay connected. Thank you so much. Have a great day.